Feliz Navidad. Welcome. This is a very special service. If you're new to us, and there are some of you here for the first time, just want to give you a little background. I think I remember this correctly, and I'm sure I'll get corrected if I don't remember it correctly. But years ago, when this church was in its infancy and its early formative years, every United Methodist Church in Mississippi shares a offering throughout the entire state of Mississippi, and the work that we do together is more than any church can do on its own. Every church has a particular amount it's supposed to pay, and there were years when we got to this time of the year and the church was short, and so they came up with this idea to do this enchanted tree. And there's a poem you'll hear and a story about the enchanted tree. And then people would come forward, and there's our Charlie Brown enchanted tree right over here. It'll be moved here to the center. And it's the same tree we used last year. It survived the entire year. That's pretty good. But if you didn't receive a little pouch and you want to make an offering, a cash offering or a check like we did at our house, there, Mr. Lindsay is at the back here, and he can give you an offering, a little pouch. But there'll be a time when we will invite you here to the chancel. But tonight, every year, the program is different. And this year is something I've never heard before. You're going to hear from some of the characters of the Christmas story as acted out by our very own folk here. And so there'll be times for you to participate as well, but there'll be music and singing and some dramatic readings. And I hope that your hearts will be warmed and continue in this spirit of Christmas. Let me remind you that on Saturday, which is Christmas Eve, we have a service at noon and a service at 5. The service will last probably anywhere from 45 to 50 minutes. There'll be some carols and some scripture readings. Amber Lee and I will be doing the readings, and we'll be singing carols, and we'll have Holy Communion. And Curry and I are going to sing O Holy Night, which is a tradition in our ministries and the churches we've served. And we'll share in candlelight at the very end. So please enjoy that time with us here at 5, at noon and at 5 on this coming Saturday. So glad that you are here. May we worship God in spirit and truth.
My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior.
I'm pregnant.
For you, Lord, have looked with favor on your lowly servant.
I'm 14 and I'm pregnant.
You, the Almighty, have done great things for me, and holy is your name.
Mom will kill me.
You have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation.
I'm so scared. I don't know what I'm going to do.
You have shown strength with your arm and scattered the proud in their conceit.
I'm so scared.
Casting down the mighty from their thrones and lifting up the lowly.
Help me! Please, help me!
You have filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty.
It's not fair.
You have come to the aid of your servant Israel to remember the promise of mercy.
It's just not fair.
The promise made to our forebears, to Abraham and his children forever.
I'm 14 and I'm pregnant.
I have traveled many moonless nights, cold and weary, with the babe inside, and I wonder what I've done. Holy Father, you have come and chosen me now to carry your son. I am waiting in a silent prayer. I am frightened by the load I bear in a world as cold as stone. Must I walk this? Do you wonder as you watch my face if a wiser one should have had my place? But I offer
Do I look like a fool? I might not be the shiniest nail in the box, but that doesn't mean I deserve to be treated like an idiot. That's what I felt like she'd done. Mary, my intended. She told me she was pregnant. I laughed when she first said it. I mean, it would be typical of one of her jokes. But from the look on her face, fierce, determined, scared, I saw that this was no joke. I stared at her. I couldn't speak. I saw that she thought that I might hit her or spit on her. That made me so angry. How could she think that of me? I wanted to get out. I wanted to shout. I kicked a chair across the room. Mary stood her ground. I felt ashamed. How could I lose my temper like that? I breathed deep, and I said, "Who's the Father?" "God." "God," she said, artlessly. I laughed again, a sneer, really. I don't deserve to be insulted. I walked towards the door. I drop her. Release the obligation. It was more than what she deserved. She deserved to be publicly shamed and stoned. "Joseph," she said, just one word. "Joseph." It was the way she said it that mattered. It wasn't pleading. It wasn't full of tears. There was fear. It was gentle. It had authority. It was her voice, but it wasn't her voice. It was a voice that knew me, that was more intimate than any whisper in my ear. It was a voice, impossible though as it sounds, that knew my body better than I could. It was a voice, it was that voice that stopped me. It was that voice that told me I should try and trust her. It was that voice that helped me say yes to her and yes to God.
Must have been surprised at where this road had taken him. Never in a million lives would he have dreamed of Bethlehem. And standing at the manger, he saw with his own eyes. The message from the angel come to life. Why me? I'm just a simple man of trade. Why him? All the rulers in the world. Why here? Inside this stable filled with hay. Why her? She's just an ordinary girl. Now I'm not one to second guess what angels have to say. This is such a strange way to save the world. Think of how it could have been if Jesus had come as he deserved. Would have been no better. The lowly shepherd at his birth. But Joseph knew the reason love had to reach so far. And as he held the Savior in his arms, he must have thought, why me? I'm just a simple man of trade. Why him? With all the rulers in the world. Why here? Inside this stable filled with hay. Why her? She's just an ordinary girl. Now I'm not one to second guess what angels have to say. This is such a strange way to save the world.
Hospitality. It's part of our faith. We're supposed to be hosts as God is host. To welcome strangers as God welcomes strangers. As if we're that simple. A Roman told me once that in his language, the word hospitality comes from the same root word as enemy and guest. Now that makes sense. Because there's nothing really pure about hospitality, right? Someone always wants something. Can anything be freely given, freely received? I don't know why I ignored my instinct when the couple knocked on my door. There'd been dozens of them all day, every day for a week, forced to travel for the sake of the census. And I was sympathetic, of course. The regime was making these ridiculous demands on decent people. But I had nothing. I barely had enough for my own family. I told most of these refugees to head to the camp at the edge of town. I mean, I know the conditions were terrible, but it was the best that we could offer. Our community was overwhelmed. But it was late when I heard that knock, and I went and answered, and I launched into my spiel. I'm sorry, we have no room. But the couple just stood there, and they waited for me to finish. They were so exhausted. The man was wild with exhaustion. The woman, well, the girl, breathless. She was in pain, and I thought that she was hurt, but then I saw she was extremely pregnant. The man said, please. And then I was angry because I felt manipulated. Couldn't they see that I had nothing? Couldn't they get that it had been people like them banging on my door all week long? They stared at me. I can't help. I'm sorry, I said. My wife, the man said, pointing at her belly. But I was sick of the sob stories, so I began to shut the door. Wait, it was the girl. I was in shock of hearing a female voice that stopped me, because women don't usually speak. Please, she said, for the baby, somewhere dry for when it comes. I looked at her. She was a kid, but she was tough. She had nothing left except determination to get that baby born. So I stared at her, nodded, and I showed them to a shelter out back. It was adequate. It was dry. You've been blessed by God, said the girl. When he comes, he will bless you.
About this baby boy who's come to earth to bring us joy, and I just wanna sing this song to you. It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, and the major lift. With every breath I'm singing hallelujah. Couple came to Bethlehem expecting child. They searched the inn to find a place, for you were coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born. Oh, shepherds left their flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Emmanuel and Savior. At which you were, their frankincense and gold and myrrh they gave to you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
We had no business being here. Our place is out in the hills and wilderness, or guarding the sheepfold. The glory we know is seen in clear night skies, the stars uncountable. The goodness we know is a job well done. It gets cold out on those hills, and everyone sees strange things. In the dark, a bush becomes a wolf. But I've never seen the stars become angels before. But we have seen another glory too. We know we're not always loved as shepherds. Some say we're not respectable. Others think we're a symbol of God's love. No one ever quite sees us for what we are. Women and men trying to do a difficult job, just wanting a smidge of respect. But that's the glory of what we've seen. Not the glory of a sky turned to a song. Not the glory of the kings and queens of old. Not even the glory told in the scriptures. We saw a child, and that child saw us. That night, we were not disreputable. We were not symbols of Israel. We were just plain old men and women. Because that's what a baby does. He's not interested in anything other than being loved and cared for. He responds to love. The parents, let me take him in my hands, my unwashed and greasy hands. I held the holy child, and that holy child held me.
I've been looking at the night sky my whole life. I've dreamed I've walked the length of the Milky Way. I thought, as a child, that it was a path to heaven. Do stars tell us anything? They tell us about the visions of the powerful and the ambitious for sure. Stars show us our dream. Stars show us our dreams and projections. I have my own theory. They're just light. Light from the time, another age. Light reaching us, pointing the way. That's what I thought when we saw the star. That's what convinced me to leave home. That's what I found to be true after the countless miles, the dead ends, and finally, in our discovery of the child. A star gives itself to show the way. It dies in its giving. It's the grace that has no concern for itself, and it pointed us into the true light of the world.
star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawns. Give us the lamp to light the way unto the land of perfect day. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on, shine
on. Oh, come and see a Christmas tree, bare and plain can be. As God looks down from heaven above, cover me with leaves of love. Share your bounty, search your soul, fill me up with gifts of gold. Your magic touch will make of me a glorious enchanted tree, whose roots are planted in the sod and gets its nourishment from God, with arms to help humanity from now through all eternity. As you bow down on bended knee, bless our Lord who blesses thee, and do your share, whatever may be, to help God make this special tree.
Thank you.
Invite everyone to join us in the fellowship hall immediately after this service for our happy birthday Jesus party. We do have cake, so I hope y'all come. As we go from here this evening, may we go with this blessing. May the song of the angels, the joy of the shepherds, the wisdom of the magi, the faith of Joseph, the courage of Mary, and the peace of the Christ child be with you now and always. Amen.